nice to be here. First time in Copenhagen. First time talking about this project to an audience that's not at the Media Lab. So it's kind of exciting to have you as first timers for myself. So yeah, I'm Edwina Portocarrero. This project is called The Never-Ending Storytelling Machine. In lieu of a better name, it was coined in 2 seconds, became catchy and stayed for some reason. But anyway. And the project was done along David Robert Schanfolmer from the Media Lab and Michelle Chung from Harvard Graduate School of Education. And it started as a class project, and sort of it evolved to be like this huge project that now has been taking over my research program. So what is a never-ending storytelling machine? In a short sentence, or not so short, it's a paper-based creation platform that allows synchronous viewing and physical editing of shared media at a distance. So it's kind of a long, too many words in one sentence name. But I'll show you a video so that you kind of get a better idea of how the interaction works, and then I'll go and describe step by step what's happening. First, I'll talk about the inspiration, what made this project happen. This was a class project. It started as a class project. And I was reading Gianni Rodari's The Grammar of Fantasy. I don't know if anybody's acquainted with that book here. It's a beautiful book where he proposes a lot of putting imagination in creative play, imaginative play. So the book has all these primers for children to be able to start stories. So his big question is the what if. So he's taking the what if and applying it to all these scenarios. So for example, what if, I don't know, the sky was green, or what if Little Red Riding Hood discovered that she was Romulo and Remo's sister, I don't know. So like he's just priming everybody. The other inspiration was Wallace Stevens' quote, who says the imagination is the power of the mind over the possibilities of things. So, as you'll see in this project, we'll take a lot of objects and try to make them digital and part of storytelling. And Mitch Resnick's approach to creative learning, in which he states that this should be the cycle for every kind of creative learning to happen. So you start by imagining, you follow by creation, you play while you create, you share, you reflect on what happened, and you imagine again. So it's a lot hands-on, it's very hands-on. motivation. So everybody had different ideas in the group of what we wanted to do, but they all kind of had a common thread, and we were trying to integrate them into the project. So the first one was trying to merge analog and digital input for creation. Another one was to make a project that valued the creative process itself, not only the results, but what happens in the process of getting to that result. Another one was reflection as an integral part of creation. So we believe that to create, you have to reflect and take in consideration your own experiences and what you have in order to make a meaningful project. Another one was individual flow as well as collaborator. There's a lot of people that like to collaborate and work great in teams, but there's a lot of people that work better when they're alone. And they're better at receiving feedback than at being put into a group and trying to collaborate with strangers. We wanted to make a project that was inviting, approachable, and easy to use, and therefore using paper as a medium. And we wanted to make it accessible, modular, and portable. So I'll show you the video how this works. So we have 2 platforms and they're coin creation stations. There's a sketchbook with a tag. I'll go step by step on what's happening. project in a nutshell. So what's happening here and what do we have? How does it work? So each creation station is composed of the main components. So it's a short throw projector, which so far is the most expensive part of the project. We're trying to see how to make it with bigger projectors and shrinking and minimize the cost. We have a computer, we have a regular paper sketchbook. This case is a large one, but it could be anything. We have a tag. We're using reactive vision for the tag right now. We have an Arduino that controls the snap button, which is just a big arcade red button. We have an audio capture button, we have a microphone, a capture camera, a tag reading camera, and it's not networked to the other station. So that's it. It's pretty simple, and people need no expertise to use it. Network creation stations access each other's file systems and read images and sounds. It's a camera and projector system capturing display content. A red button captures images of physical objects or drawings on the current page of a sketchbook. The captured content is displayed on each creation station and the page was captured on. Flipping the pages change the projected content to match the current page. The software was all custom done in Touch Designer, which is a really nice visual programming environment. Arduino listens for the button press and communicates it to OSC. Via OSC to Touch Designer, video input from the webcam is run through a homography process. That's a tricky part where you have to basically fit the image that you have to fit the sketchbook that you're projecting on. Not that complicated, but. And the second camera is reading the tag, and everything's built in a scalable modular structure, so you don't have to necessarily have two creation stations. You can have 3, 4, 10, as many as you want. There's a projection, there's a little projection in the side that tells you what page you're in and what page your friend or collaborator is in. So that allows for a synchronous collaboration. So I could be on page 10 while my friend is on page 20, and I'll be working on page 10, he'll be working on page 20, and when I flip to page 20, he'll see what I made for him and vice versa. So how does it all tie together? So yeah, this picture is of a user. She's writing her story, she saw material, she decided that green would be good for trees. She's putting physical objects, she's snapping it, and it's captured in the page along with the text. So what happened at the end? So how did we accomplish everything that we had for motivations? By being able to stamp physical objects and augment digital pre-created content, we were able to merge analog and digital input. The book has a memory. Since everything is captured digitally at the end, you have everything that happened in each page of the book. So you have a history of the creative process that if you wanted, you could project on another book. So you can totally see the history of what happened before you arrive to your final point. Reflection as a part of creation, since it just keeps the last layer of what you created, you can like step back and come back, and it's an asynchronous collaboration, so you don't have to be at the same place at the same time to collaborate. You can, as I said, you can wake up and see what your friend made for you the morning after. Individual flow. It's an individual creation station, so you are on your own, working on your thing, and you just share it whenever you want it. You are not forced to be on a ping pong mode unless you wanted to. Inviting, approachable, and easy to use. There's no instructions needed. There's a big red button. That's all you need. You snap it, and there's another button for audio. That's it. And when we demoed at the lab, it was pretty nice to see like CEOs of big companies come and share it with five-year-olds and like, you know, some illustrating other stories. And it opened a world of possibilities for everybody. This girl had a tie-dye t-shirt that she decided was a perfect sunset for her story, right? So she was using her t-shirt, she went running around, collecting leaves, bringing them back. And suddenly the world became filled with potential for creative endeavor, which was what we wanted. accessible, modular, and portable. Accessible paper, it's really accessible for everybody. You don't need to be an expert on any medium. If you feel more comfortable working on digital media, since it's a projector and a camera and a computer, you can load an architectural plan if you wanted to. You could load whatever you wanted and edit it either with a pen or with crayons or with whatever you have. The book format is familiar and it's very inviting for a narrative. Like, people know how to use it, you know, like they come, they bring it, they open it, and And you could potentially have a library with different books having different content. You could have the book of that you did with your child, as you can have the book that you are making out of your travelogue in Copenhagen, right? Where you're putting your Ubicomp little thingy and, you know, you're materializing everything into one form. And I don't know how we are on time.
You have more time if you want.
Okay. Well, I have another video, which is an interview of the girl, and she's telling what she saw about it and explaining without previous knowledge how she missed it. Oy. Should I? Are there speakers? I don't know.
Oh, I don't know. Let's see.
Audio? I don't know if you can hear otherwise, but
No, I don't think so.
Well, I'll pump up the volume and maybe just the first row will be the privileged one. She speaks really slow too. You can hear anything.
No, we can't hear what. So what does she say?
She's saying that I like it because you can draw over what other people drew. I like that it was a sketchbook and that it was a real sketchbook, which makes it portable too, which is really nice. Like a machine that transfers what you have to the other side. Wherever that other side is. The cool thing about it is that you can put an object and the object is not going to show on the other side, but I call it the shadow. More like the projection. Appears on the other side. If you flip the page, it will actually come back to that. Oy. Ah.
Anyway.
I think that you could not only play with it, but have a story. And she talks about it. It would be a way to put your story to an editor or something. And they could send it back to you. And comment on your story or something. I wrote a story. And you can make really cool illustrations. Because you can put anything. And if it's the illustration of the something, you can actually put that something. And then you don't have to draw it. That's a later girl talking. I might use a disco ball. That's very nice. Anyway, so yeah, this is
okay.
A never ending.
Thank you.
So
we have time for questions and comments.